Random House Audio presents Black Sunday by Thomas Harris. Read for you by Ron McLarty.
Night fell as the airport taxi rattled along the 6 miles of coastal road into Beirut. From the back seat, Dahlia Iyad watched the Mediterranean surf fade from white to gray in the last light. She was thinking about the American. She would have to answer many questions about him. The taxi turned onto the Rue Verdun and threaded its way into the heart of the city, the Sabra district, filled with many of the refugees from Palestine. The driver needed no instructions. He scanned his rearview mirror closely, then turned off his lights and pulled into a small courtyard near the Rue Jeb El Nahel. A minute passed.
"Get out and follow me," a man with a pistol instructed her.
He ran the Arabic words together in the accent of the Jabal. A hard tribunal waited for Dahlia Iyad in the quiet room. Hafez Najir, head of Al-Fatah's elite Jihaz al-Raz field intelligence unit, sat at a desk with his head against the wall. He was a tall man with a small head. His subordinates secretly called him the Praying Mantis. To hold his full attention was to feel sickened and frightened. Najir was the commander of Black September. He did not believe in the concept of a Middle East situation. The restoration of Palestine to the Arabs would not have elated him. He believed in Holocaust, the fire that purifies. So did Dahlia Iyad. And so did the other two men in the room. Abu Ali, who controlled the Black September assassination squads in Italy and France, and Mohammed Fazil, ordnance expert and architect of the attack on the Olympic Village at Munich. It was these three men who decided that Black September would strike within the United States. More than 50 plans had been conceived and discarded. Meanwhile, U.S. munitions continued to pour onto the Israeli docks at Haifa. Suddenly, a solution had come. And now, if Najir gave his final approval, the mission would be in the hands of the young woman. She tossed her jalaba on a chair and faced them.
"Good evening, comrades."
"Welcome, Comrade Dahlia," Najir said. He had not risen when she entered the room, nor had the other two.
"The American is ready," she said. "I am satisfied that he will go through with it. He lives for it."
"How stable is he?" Najir seemed to be staring into her skull.
"Stable enough. I support him. He depends on me."
"I understand that from your reports, but code is clumsy. There are questions, Ali."
Abu Ali looked at Dahlia carefully. She remembered him from his psychology classes at the American University in Beirut.
"The American always appears rational?" he asked.
"Yes."
"But you believe him to be insane?"
"Sanity and apparent rationality are not the same, comrade."
"Is his dependency on you increasing? Does he have periods of hostility toward you?"
"Sometimes he is hostile, but not as often now."
"Is he impotent?"
"He says he was impotent from the time of his release in North Vietnam until 2 months ago."
With his small, neat gestures and his moist eyes, Ali reminded Dahlia of a civet cat.
"Do you take credit for overcoming his impotence?"
"It is not a matter of credit, comrade. It is a matter of control. My body is useful in maintaining control. If a gun worked better, I would use a gun."
Najir nodded approval. He knew she was telling the truth. Dahlia had helped train the three Japanese terrorists who struck at Lod Airport in Tel Aviv. Originally, there had been 4 Japanese terrorists. One lost his nerve in training, and with the other three watching, Dahlia blew his head off with a Schmeisser machine pistol.
"How can you be sure he will not have an attack of conscience and turn you into the Americans?"
Ali persisted.
"What would they get if he did?" Dahlia said. "I am a small catch. They would get the explosives, but the Americans have plenty of plastique already, as we have good reason to know." This was intended for Najir. She saw him look up at her sharply. Israeli terrorists almost invariably used American C4 plastic explosive. Najir remembered carrying his brother's body out of a shattered apartment in Bandung, then going back inside to look for the legs. The American turned to us because he needed explosives. You know that, comrade, Dahlia said. He will continue to need me for other things. We do not offend his politics because he has none. Neither does the term conscience apply to him in the usual sense. He will not turn me in.
Let's look at him again, Najir said. Comrade Dahlia, you have studied this man in one setting. Let me show him to you in quite different circumstances. Ali?
Abu Ali set a 16mm movie projector on the desk and switched out the lights.
We got this quite recently from a source in North Vietnam, Comrade Dahlia. It was shown once on American television, but that was before you were stationed in the House of War. I doubt you have seen it.
The image of a tall, gaunt man in the baggy uniform of a POW appeared now on the wall. 2 dozen other American POWs sat on the floor in front of him. The speaker began to read.
I am Michael J. Lander, Lieutenant Commander, U.S. Navy, captured February 10, 1967, while firebombing a civilian hospital near Ninh Binh. Though the evidence of my war crimes is unmistakable, the Democratic Republic of Vietnam has not done to me punishment, but showed me the suffering which resulted from American war crimes like those of my own and others. I am sorry for what I have done. I am sorry we killed children. I call upon the American people to stop this war. The Democratic Republic of Vietnam holds no animosity toward the American people. It is the warmongers in power.
Firebombing a hospital,
Ali mused as the film abruptly ended.
He has experience in this sort of thing, then.
He was captured flying a rescue helicopter, Dahlia said. He was trying to retrieve the crew of a downed Phantom. You have seen my report.
I have seen what he told you, Najir said.
He tells me the truth, she said. I have lived with him for 2 months, I know.
It's a small point anyway, Ali said. There are other things about him of much more interest.
During the next half hour, Ali questioned her about the most intimate details of the American's behavior. When he had finished, it seemed to Dahlia that there was a smell in the room. Real or imagined, it took her back to the Palestinian refugee camp at Tyre when she was 8 years old, folding the wet bedroll where her mother and the man who brought food had groaned in the dark. Fazil took over the questioning. He had the blunt, capable hands of a technician, and there were calluses on the tips of his fingers. He sat forward in his chair, his small satchel on the floor beside him.
Has the American handled explosives?
Only packaged military ordnance, but he has planned carefully and in minute detail. His plan appears reasonable, Dahlia answered.
It appears reasonable to you, comrade. Perhaps because you are so intimately involved with it. We will see how reasonable it is.
She wished for the American then. Wish these men could hear his slow voice as step by step he reduced his terrible project into a series of clearly defined problems, each with a solution. She took a deep breath and began to talk about the technical problems involved in killing more than 80,000 people all at once, including the new president of the United States, with an entire nation watching.
The limitation is weight, Dahlia said. We are restricted to 600 kilos of plastique. Give me a cigarette, please, and a pen and paper.
Bending over the desk, she drew a curve that resembled a cross-section of a bowl. Inside it and slightly above, she drew another, smaller curve of the same parameter.
This is the target, she said, indicating the larger curve. Her pen moved to the smaller curve. The principle of the shaped charge, it...
Yes, Fazil snapped. Like a great claymore mine, simple. The density of the crowd?
Seated shoulder to shoulder, entirely exposed at this angle from the pelvis up. I need to know if the plastique...
Comrade Najir will tell you what you need to know, Fazil said loftily.
Dahlia continued unfazed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.